It's not enough to just build a system and hope it works. We have to make sure that it meets the goals of the people who use it, that it works well, and that we have the confidence that it'll withstand expected and some unexpected situations. In other words, the software systems that we build must be continuously reliable. In this video, I'm going to go over what we can do to work towards continuous reliability, and also about how some open source Grafana Labs projects fit into that picture. When it comes right down to it, there are a few main concerns in observability. First is identifying the data to collect. There's lots of different types of data, different components, different levels, front-end and back-end, among others. How do we know what's important? Secondly is collecting the data. Different types of data have different requirements about how they're stored and how they're aggregated, if they even can be. And number three is doing stuff about data. After we have all that data, what does it all mean and what can we do about it? We're going to go over all of these. When we're identifying data to collect, we need to think about what we're actually observing, what types of data exist, and where do we store them. Observability really is about different types of data, what we call telemetry signals. I'm going to go over a few in this video, namely logs, metrics, traces, and profiles. Each type of data has unique storage requirements, and if we don't optimize for the specific type of data signal that it is, then storage can get costly, either from a dollar perspective or from a computing resources perspective, or likely both. So I'm going to mention some databases for the different signals, but they're going to have a few things in common. Each database is optimized for a specific signal. It's possible to use one for all, but it's not the best way to do it. The databases also have to be horizontally scalable and multi-tenant, so you can have multiple instances of it when your usage exceeds having a single instance of it. All the databases I'm going to mention are built for scalability and multi-tenancy. And lastly, each database has a slightly different query language that, again, is optimized for letting you find stuff for that specific telemetry signal. First up is logs. Logs are chronological records of events or other output while a component is running. They're kind of like a running feed of context about what's happening in a particular component. There are a few concerns with logs. First, there's the difficulty in parsing because you can pretty much send everything to logs, and that can be kind of difficult when you're trying to find out certain things within them. There's also increasing storage needs because there's a lot to a log, so where do you keep it so that you're still keeping what's useful, but you're also not just storing everything? And then there's the complexity of the retrieval from ephemeral sources. If you have logs within a Kubernetes pod, for example, that specific pod may not be there tomorrow. So how do you make sure that you get it out of there and still store them somewhere that persists? And then lastly, there's aggregation. With something like logs, it can be lots of different things. How do you sort of combine them and roll them up in a meaningful way? Grafana's solution for that is Loki. Loki is a database for logs. Some of the cool things about it are that Loki only indexes the metadata instead of the full text of a log, so not only are queries faster, but the storage requirements are reduced since it effectively stores in object storage a table of contents rather than the entire book. You might have also heard that Loki is like Prometheus, but for logs. We'll get to Prometheus soon, but what you need to know is that the query language LogQL is very similar to PromQL, the query language for Prometheus, and it works with Prometheus Alert Manager. So there's a lot of integrations there that really tie it to Prometheus for those who are already using it. Now we're getting to metrics. Metrics are numbers that tell us something about the system at specific points in time. They're good for getting a quick quantitative read into how a system's doing, and because they're numbers, you can aggregate them across multiple components or over time. Some of the concerns about metrics are that metrics are not as good at explaining why a number is what it is or troubleshooting an issue. There's also no context, just numbers, so you kind of have to find that elsewhere. And then lots of numbers on their own don't mean anything. So you need to do some sort of aggregation for a number to mean something. And that aggregation can take a long time or take a lot of resources. Prometheus solves a lot of these problems. It is a database for metrics, but instead of using file structures to store data like traditional databases, it uses labels. And that makes it really performant. It works well with microservices and Kubernetes, and the query language is called PromQL. PromQL is a multi-dimensional query language, so you can query along a lot of different tags. Prometheus also has exemplar, so you don't need to rely on just the high-level aggregated overview numbers. So you can look at an exemplar, so a sample of a specific period in time, so you can look at the real data. And Prometheus also supports push and pull-based monitoring. So Prometheus can exist and then receive data that your application components push to it, or Prometheus can actively go and pull that data over to the database. Now, Mimir is kind of like an addition to Prometheus, and there are two main things that it does. The first is that it provides long-term storage, object storage, for Prometheus, and it's also natively multi-tenant, which is something that Prometheus is not as good at. So if you need more than one instance of Prometheus, then Mimir is your best bet. Mimir is like Prometheus, but horizontally scalable and reliable. The third telemetry signal is traces. Distributed traces are kind of like logs, but instead of being about a service or component, traces are like logs about a single transaction, like a request, as it's processed by multiple services. So tracing builds the story of where that request went and how long it took where. Some concerns about tracing are that it can be quite expensive because there's a lot of information to store. Tracing is also meaningless if you can't correlate it with other information about what else was happening in the system at the time. It's an in-depth view, not a bird's eye view. And then tracing also only works if all the components are instrumented, which means that there's quite a bit of setup that you need to do before you are able to get traces that actually mean something. Tempo is the database for distributed tracing. The query language for Tempo is something called TraceQL, which is different from PromQL and LogQL in that those two are really based around streams or key-value pairs. But traces need more information than that. They can be numbers, strings, arrays, or even something like maps of arrays of maps of strings. TraceQL is more pipe-based and is better suited to the information you need for distributed traces. While metrics and logs are still important, traces and Tempo are awesome at drilling down very deep and following the path of one transaction. So they're very good for troubleshooting in general. The fourth telemetry signal is continuous profiles. A continuous profile is information about how much computing power or resources are used by an application, and that's collected at specific intervals over time. It's kind of like a bunch of metrics in that it can tell you, for example, the CPU or memory utilization of an application. But it's also kind of like a trace because you can also drill down from the overall utilization down to the specific function calls that are involved. The concerns for continuous profiling are that traditionally this process took up a lot of overhead. Collecting information about the CPU, for example, can sometimes add work to the CPU, and that extra bit of work can make a difference to the overall functioning of the component. And then comparing CPU utilization can be difficult because when you're trying to decide on whether a new build used up fewer or more resources, it's kind of hard to tell what to compare exactly. Do you get the average? Do you plot the data on a logarithmic scale to reduce outliers? It can get a little complicated. Pyroscope is a database for continuous profiles and it's built for performance. Depending on the complexity of your application, you can expect an overhead of between 1 to 10% for the collection of continuous profiles, which is pretty cool. Pyroscope doesn't store everything. It samples by default at an interval of 15 seconds, but you can change that. It doesn't store individual metrics. Instead, it only stores just enough information to show the shape of the entire profile. and it also uses object storage to do it, making storage costs lower. To solve the comparison problem, Pyroscope helps visualize this shape as flame graphs, and you can even do diffs of flame graphs so that you can figure out when a function that you modified in the last build is taking up way more memory than it used to. You can also query profiles using a language called FlameQL, so you can quickly find profiles based on tags. So there are four different types of data, but they're spread out in different places. So where do you actually get the data from? One approach is to capture information that's already being generated. This is called instrumentation, and there are a few ways that you can do this. You can do source instrumentation, which means adding code that saves the information that you require during runtime in a specific format. Usually this means using things like SDKs, libraries, and other tools that are based on the language that you're using. On the front-end side, Grafana Faro is a collection of SDKs that let you do real user monitoring of an application. You put some JavaScript in your web app, and that lets you see how your users experience it. You can think of this as a sort of front-end observability. It looks at things like the Google Core Web Vitals, so it looks at the loading, the interactivity, and even the visual stability of elements on the page. And then on the back-end side, there's something called OpenTelemetry, which is a collection of APIs, tools, and SDKs that have become the industry standard for how different telemetry signals are collected. And this is all to do with the back-end. You can also do what's called binary instrumentation, which means modifying the binary of the application or infrastructure component without modifying the underlying code. Now, this could involve adding an agent to the components that you want to monitor. This agent then sits on that component and then collects the information and then communicates that information to the rest of the observability stack. So we talked about OpenTelemetry earlier. There is an OpenTelemetry collector that is an agent that does this. However, we also have something called Grafana Alloy, which is kind of like an opinionated version of the OpenTelemetry collector that happens to work well with the rest of the Grafana stack. So it's a telemetry collector for Mimir or Prometheus for metrics, Loki for logs, Tempo for traces, Pyroscope for continuous profiles, and other OpenTelemetry endpoints. Alloy is really important because instrumentation can be a real pain, and Alloy is kind of like the plumbing. You sure miss it when it's gone, and you want it to always be working. Alloy also has a new flow mode, which is turning it into a bit more of a data pipeline. It's more of a modular approach where you can have better flexibility on routing and transforming the data that Alloy collects. Some approaches to instrumentation don't modify either the code or the binary itself, and we can loosely lump these into external instrumentation. For example, in a language like Go, you can attach to the binary without modifying or instrumenting the binary itself, and just listen for signals at breakpoints or established safe periods within the program. Grafana Bela is a new eBPF auto-instrumentation tool, and it employs a mix of approaches depending on the programming language and the protocol. eBPF is a technology that allows developers to run programs in an operating system kernel, so at a much lower level, without having to change the kernel source code itself or use kernel modules. There are usually two sides to an eBPF program. First, there's code on the kernel side, written in C, and then there's code on the user space side, written in Go or some other language. Bela captures signals for application monitoring, not infrastructure monitoring. And right now, that means information about the HTTP and gRPC protocols. For example, you can deploy Bela as a sidecar container in a Kubernetes cluster, and you can just start capturing HTTP and gRPC information. So that means it can tell you typical things you might expect, like response time, but it'll also be able to tell you things like the length of time before a Go routine actions a request, which you can only really see at a kernel level. So all of these approaches to instrumentation are about collecting data that's already being generated, but sometimes there's no data to collect, such as when something hasn't even gone to production yet. What do you do then? I mean, you could just wait until it's live, or you could trigger it earlier so that you know what to expect. This is called software testing. Some concerns around testing are how to make the synthetic environment of a test environment more realistic so that the data that it generates is useful and mappable to production. And also, how can we make this entire process systematic and repeatable? K6 is an open source reliability testing tool. It is written in Go, but the scripts themselves are written in JavaScript, and it provides a framework with which to design tests to very exact specifications. It's more than just hitting endpoints. It's also simulating user flows on the protocol and browser levels, defining independent scenarios with differing load schedules, even injecting faults into components on purpose. With K6, you can get information on the network or protocol level, or even on the browser level, like a lot of the Core Web Vitals that we were talking about with Faro. You can also do synthetic monitoring with K6. Synthetic monitoring is a way to use a very low level of load in production to test different endpoints. It's called synthetic because they're not real users, but it's still monitoring because it's a way of kind of putting your finger on the pulse of your system while it's live. So that's how you collect information either through instrumentation or by generating the data using testing. But what do you do when you get that data? Because you can end up with a lot of it. How do you actually assess the impact on your system and make that actionable? Let's talk about doing stuff with data. The first is visualization. All the data in the world won't do you any good if you don't have a way to make sense of it. Everything I mentioned, every project that I mentioned, can send information to Grafana. Grafana is a visualization tool, but it can take almost any form of input and then display it in a way that you can configure. So there are plugins to get data into Grafana called data sources, and then plugins to display that data in different ways called panels. Then there are also apps that can be combinations of data sources, panels, and even other actions to fulfill a certain need or use case. So it's super flexible for whatever you're using it for. It's not actually just for observability. You can also set up rules to alert you based on the data that you get. For example, maybe you want to know when the CPU utilization of a component exceeds a certain threshold. And that gets us into the next topic of what to do with all of that data. And that's incident response and remediation. Alerting can be dangerous because too many alerts are just as bad, if not worse, than no alerts. When alerts are going off all the time, and sometimes for things that aren't important, our tendency is to eventually ignore them. To combat this, alerts must be unambiguously useful, timely, and appropriately routed. OnCall is an open source tool that makes sure real issues are properly addressed. It manages on-call schedules so that you know who's available to help. It automates escalations when something goes wrong so that the right people and only the right people are notified. And in the right way. You can use OnCall to get notified via Slack, Telegram, phone, email, and even a mobile app. Just like everything, OnCall works with Grafana too. So Grafana is really at the center of this entire stack of tools. Grafana is the one-stop shop for everything you need to know about your application's current state and also what you need to do to improve it. So observability is really about building systems in such a way that its outputs can be studied. It involves identifying what type of information would actually be useful to collect so that you can answer not just expected questions about your system state, but also unexpected ones. It is about exposing and collecting that information in a way that is unobtrusive, performant, and flexible enough to transform that information if needed. But we're not observing just to observe, or at least we shouldn't be. We're observing so that we can make our systems more reliable. So observability also requires that we present all the information in a way that is understandable and actionable, and that ensures that the right people can do something about it. Only by doing all of this can we make sure that our systems are continuously reliable. If you'd like to learn more about Grafana, then check out this playlist for Grafana for Beginners, or check out the links below for documentation on how to get started with any of the projects I mentioned.